Now, this is my pleasure to introduce leading figures for our family. I will give the floor, first of all, to Irache Garcia Perez, the president of our S&D group, a critical actor of progressive forces. I'd like to underline that we are very proud that over the last period, and it's such a difficult situation, coping with COVID crisis, preparing the big transformation with the Green Deal, digital transition, tackling social inequalities, launching the plan to implement the social pillar, the progressive family was in the leading role. And we have with us now the leading figures. And Irache Garcia Perez is also member of the executive board of the Conference on the Future of Europe. So it's my great pleasure to welcome you, Irache, and let's listen to you first of all.
Thank you, Maria Joao, dear friends, dear colleagues. First of all, tell you that I am very happy to be part of this year edition of Call to Europe. I am very grateful to FEPS for the invitation to speak as a president of the S&D group in the European Parliament. The Call to Europe is a great opportunity to exchange, debate and evaluate the state of play of our political movement in Europe. I hope this exchange with Sergei contribute to our discussion in the future of Europe. We are living extraordinary times, of course. The main challenges of today simply don't have borders. Inequalities, pandemics, climate change, and digitalization. We are all faced with these challenges, no matter where we live. Our main goal now is to overcome the effects of the pandemic. And this will require a big effort in almost all policy areas. At the same time, the Union must not lose sight of the climate emergency, the growing inequalities, the digital transformation, and the relationship and trust with the citizens. Unfortunately, we also have to tackle the deterioration of the rule of law and a new wave of populism and nationalism. At the European level, we need to have the courage to move forward, to explain that a response based on national solutions will only increase the gap between countries, regions, and groups of people. The enemies of solidarity and the European Union are using the pandemic and the crisis to apply their nationalist anti-EU agenda. We can only fight with a strong European response. We need to show our citizens the benefit of having the EU in their daily lives. We need to show that they are the center of the EU policies. This cannot be an empty slogan. We need a comprehensive strategy to ensure a better life for European citizens in every aspect of their life. We have to ensure a solid economic, social, equal, and ecological recovery with a just transition. This issue is so essential for our political movement. The just transition is very important in this moment. Austerity times are over. I know that for some people it is difficult to accept because it's also proof that they are having a room for many years. Fiscal rules should exist to serve people, their life, and not to the opposite. Even the most recent European Council conclusion from the Porto Summit recognize this. We welcome this recognition from those who defend austerity during the past decade. This only acknowledges that we were right from the beginning. As a political family, we should be proud of our leadership and contribution to the Porto Summit. We need to explore this window of opportunity. It is possible to repair the system in which our societies operate in a way that will guarantee human progress for all in the future. A future without destroying our planet without exploiting workers and without witness an ever-growing concentration of wealth and power in a few hands. Fighting the pandemic is still the most pressing challenge on the agenda. We cannot do it alone because nobody will be safe until we all are safe. This is important in this moment, and we are insisting a lot in the European Parliament. Of course, to save people in Europe is essential, but we need to understand that this pandemic only will finalize when everybody on the goal can be safe. Internally, we are fighting for an inclusive health union, and we have the best example with the European strategy of vaccination. But at the same time, climate change and the continuing destruction for our planet biodiversity are facing people across the globe. Global and European efforts to limit climate change and to preserve biodiversity have taken center stage in recent years. The Paris Agreement is a great example of successful, but we have to do more, and all the major emits certain change to a net zero pathway ahead of COP26 Glasgow Summit. A good balance between the environment and the social dimension is also crucial, of course, to reduce inequalities. They are two sides of the same coin and must go together. This is why we welcome the new present action plan to implementation of the European social rights. We are pleased that our social dimension is the core matter of the current Portuguese presidency of the Council. During the social summit in Porto, the EU institutions sent a strong signal and commitment to the European citizens. A resilient society also requires truce between citizens and institutions. The framework decision on combating racism and xenophobia, as well as the Race Equality Directive, should be fully implemented, and we were urgently need an agreement on the horizontal anti-discrimination directive. A resilient society also means more inclusion and solidarity. For a new pact of migration and asylum that in this moment we know that is urgent actions we ask for a long time in the European Parliament, and I think that we must to be prepared for push the new pact immigration and asylum. All this need show that we need more common EU actions. Citizens expect more from us. And we have to do everything thinking in the citizens. We want citizens to tell us what they concern. And for this reason, it's very important to think now in this moment about our work in the conference on the future of Europe. As you say, Maria Joao, the conference on the future of Europe is a great opportunity because politicians need to listen and give voice to citizens. It's essential. The citizens must to be the center of this conference. The Socialists and Democrats have pushed for establish a citizens panel with a constant feedback system to inform the institutional plenary of the conference. The pandemic has provided us with new tools to connect online. Nothing can replace, of course, human encounters, but the new technologies and the fact that have become used to virtual interaction should facilitate innovative ways to ensure citizens can participate in this way. Democracy will only be depend through this conference if we really involve those who are usually excluded from the public debate. Therefore, a feminist approach to this conference is needed. Half of Europeans must be represented our power. We need to ensure that everyone is involved. This is why we, Socialists and Democrats, insist that it's necessary to guarantee the young voices in this conference, and for that we worked to guarantee that one third of these citizens panels should be under 25, because they must be protagonists in deciding their ONF future. We need a new concept of power, a new approach to representative democracy, and a new mind in the EU institutions. These transformations should be also reflected in the institutional architecture. COVID-19 has clearly shown that the common challenges require a common answer. This crisis really can't should be an opportunity to return to the essential, to restore the spirit of solidarity. If COVID-19 has shown us anything, is that we are a community that depends on each other of all levels, from everything we need from the others. We need this conference more than ever. It is the time to make the EU stronger for the future, but we cannot do it alone. And this is an important reflection. And this conference and this event now is a great example to have this opportunity to listen and include the participation of a political representation, social partners, and civil society. Our political family can play an important role. The political leadership, the activists, the think tanks, and all progressive citizens can help us to frame the discussion in the best way, because our common goal is to build a Europe that is more resilient and more fair. The European project has always been about building a better future, and I am sure that together we can transform this crisis into an opportunity to build a stronger, better, and more progressive Europe. Thank you.
Many, many thanks, Irache. As you can see, you have many tasks in your hands, and you are being able to lead SD Group, a powerful actor in European politics, in an amazing direction with many achievements. Irache, many thanks for your work. And also now, the way you are engaged on the Future of Europe conference, because you have the right approach. And yes, you are right, this Call to Europe conference is already part of this larger debate. So many thanks for your message today. And now let's listen to a very important message coming from the president of our Party of European Socialists, Sergei Stanishev. Great pleasure to have you with you and with all of us. We have been together in so many episodes. And again, I think it's great to have the president of our party coming with his insights for what is at stake now. Sergei, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Maria, for inviting me to this discussion. It's great to be part of the 10th Call to Europe conference, which is a great opportunity to discuss with so many people from academia, from our political family, from the civil society, and especially young people about the future of Europe. And since it's a kind of anniversary, a jubilee 10th conference, it's good to remember and to compare where we have been as Europeans and also as socialists 10 years ago, and where we are now, what are the differences and what are the possibilities for our socialist political family. Well, first of all, if you compare, 2010-2011 was probably the peak of the austerity policies. This was one of the darkest hours in Europe's history, when the social fabric in so many countries, Spain, Greece, and many more, was destroyed for the sake of the new macroeconomic rules, which were imposed by the EPP mainly after their victory in the European elections of 2009. It was a very problematic moment for our family and for the progressives in general in Europe, because it was a big turn of the policies and it looked almost impossible to fight it. But now, 10 years later, we can see that things are changing. And we, as a political family, have our very substantial contribution for this. I would like also personally to see many changes happening faster in Europe. Because for us socialists, change is long overdue. Change towards more democratic European Union, change towards more social European Union, change towards a European Union which is creating the basis for new industrial policies which are competitive, but which are also based not just on the market, but on the idea and vision of a sustainable development and policies. But things are moving. And I think that the COVID-19 crisis created not only so many problems, which we all are aware of, so many people died, so many people were infected, so many people were isolated, but also due to its nature, it showed to everybody the deficits of the modern capitalist economy. It showed that our public health systems are underfunded. And if we want to be able to react to such pandemia, there's need for more care, more money, more focus on public health, including at European level. Everybody saw the weaknesses of our public education systems, and they need to be corrected. So the point is that, in my perception at least, in the public domain, in the public opinion, there is a possibility, a condition to listen to classical social democratic policies. And we must be aware of this and grasp the opportunity. I think that in the course of last year, our political was adequate to these challenges. Because there is no an idea, however difficult it would be from a point of view of decision-making process, which would be just put away by us. On the contrary, from the very first moment, the line of our political family was very clear. This is a common crisis. It is completely different in its origin to the crisis of 2008-2009. We need common, strong, massive European economic and social reply. And we cannot afford Europe to follow the austerity policies of 2009, 10, 11, etc. And we make a political fight on this. And I think that the recovery package, which was, after all, adopted after many months of difficult negotiations, in the institutions, and I really praise the role of the group in this process, but also of our political leaders, our prime ministers in the council, who are not in majority, but were pushing by all means for our policies to have a package which has so many novelties in its substance. Because the very idea that for the first time there is a form of mutualization of the debt, issuing a common debt of the European Union, I would say it's historical. And many more elements which are now to be implemented. And we have to focus on the delivery of this package because people are expecting, there are high hopes with the vaccination process going already now much better than 4 months ago, with the reopening of our societies and economies, but the problems are there for the companies, for the workers, and they need to see that nobody is abandoned. This is why we need a fast, speedy recovery plan implemented in every country. The other element which makes a difference to 2010-11 is that the social agenda is now much more visible thanks to the efforts of our political family. Because it is a paradox. After the previous financial and economic crisis, which was so sharp socially, so unbearable. The first social summit of the European Union happened only in 2017. And it wouldn't happen if there wouldn't be the initiative of Stefan Löfven, the Swedish Prime Minister, and the 20 principles of the European social pillar were adopted. Now we're 4 years later. And finally, after a lot of efforts from our family, we have much more concrete commitments from the leaders of the heads of state, heads of state and government, and the European Commission. Also thanks to our commissioners and Nico Schmidt in the first place as the social commissioner. But my point is that, yes, this is a change of the paradigm. Yes, social policies and elements are becoming much more central to the European Union, but without permanent pressure, without political campaigns, without coordination between all the elements of our family, we wouldn't achieve what we want until now, and we shall not be able to make the change as big in scale as we are wishing for. And I would like to focus on two other elements of the change which are coming and which are also in the priority of the European Commission, thanks to our commissioners. One is the new Green Deal, and the other is the digital change in our economies. Yes, it was a key point in Frans Timmermans' campaign that climate change has to be addressed by the European Union, and the Union should be leading. And now we have more and more elements of this policy of the new Green Deal implemented in the form of the law. And it's also part of the recovery package, with more than one third of the money, the funds, which have to be directed in this area. But I would like to stress both on this element and the digital transition, which is inevitable, which is happening faster and faster. And the last year of this COVID crisis accelerated this change economically. We have to find that these transitions are socially just. We need substantial funds to support people who will be on the losing side in the short run. We need support regions, industries, and individuals who will be suffering from this dramatic transition in our economy. This is a number one priority for us, because otherwise we shall not be able to bring people with us in this process. And simultaneously to this is the political change at the European level. And here I come to the conference on the future of Europe. It is a great opportunity for our family, but we have, first of all, to learn from the mistakes of the Constitutional Assembly of 2000 and early years of the 21st century with the draft of the Constitution. If we let the public to perceive it as another exercise of the Brussels bubble, it will be dead. And it will be very suitable to make a campaign against any new, fresh idea which can change Europe. This is why the first precondition for success of the Conference on the Future of Europe is to bring it out of Brussels to the member states, to make it visible. And this is the task for our family as well, with our group, with our national groups in the national parliaments, with our parties, with the civil society, to have a lively debate in the countries, to show that this will be important. And then to come with the ideas, including ideas which are considering the decision-making process based on the needs of the people. When people say, will say, I expect that health union is needed, then the logical question would be, okay, then what do we need to change in the institutional framework in May in order to make it work? If people would say, we need a common foreign policy where the process will be faster, on that basis, the issue of relations, the decision-making process in the Council should be put in this context. And finally, indeed, we need to see how to democratize the decision-making process, including the European elections, including we have the question, the pending issue of the Spitzenkandidat, which was our idea as socialists. We make it work twice in reality of the campaign. I would like to remind you that back in 2019, France made a brilliant campaign. It was very visible. We have a record participation in European elections, but then it was failed. And people have their skepticism growing. So we need to show that these ideas of democratization can work, and that we have to prove that the European Union, after all, is not so much and only common market and relations between member states, but it is a union of women and men of the of Europe. That's it from me. Thank you.
Many, many thanks, Sergei, for very inspiring words and a golden key to close our sequence of the call to Europe, focusing on our European future. We had a brilliant roundtable with some of the authors out of the 36 who are behind this book we just launched. I was so pleased to give the floor to our young academics and then to count on the leadership of our family to close all this sequence. This will be a high moment of this Call to Europe conference. And I strongly recommend you to get the book. The book now will be available online everywhere and very soon in bookshops, hoping they will be open. So in the printed version, this is a first input to the Conference on the Future of Europe with a lot of substance. But of course, what really matters is a very large debate, engaging with citizens across the board, across Europe. And we count on all of you to conduct this debate. So many thanks. We are closing for now, and we reconvene in the afternoon. Thank you, all of you.